election.
The elite are using Obama to pacify the public so they can usher in the North American Union by stealth, launch a new Cold War, and continue the occupation of Iraq and Afghanistan.
The globalists are outside all the nations. That gives them safety, and they play countries off against each other.
We've got to give them a stake in creating the kind of world order that I think all of us would like to see.
Partnership and cooperation among nations is not a choice. It is the only way.
What they're doing is using the existence of the United States to act out their Wall Street fantasies of world domination and maintaining their capital structures and maintaining their system of looting.
The fight that this country has been waging since its inception is for the central bankers not to take over the country.
President Barack Obama is only the tool of a larger agenda.
Senator Obama had a desire to do some meetings. Others had a desire to meet with him tonight in a private way, and that's what we're doing.
Presidential candidate Barack Obama was publicly criticizing the North American Free Trade Agreement in a bid for votes, but privately telling Canadian officials not to worry about it.
If you talk to our generals, they are desperate for is a civilian counterpart to our military force.
What do you call this thing where you get this false sense of gratification, but because a black man is in office, everything's gonna be all right? No, everything's not gonna be all right.
So I know how unpopular it is to be seen as helping banks right now, especially when everyone is suffering in part from their bad decisions. I promise you, I get it.
The Obama deception. The truth strikes back. Get your copy of The Obama Deception today at Infowars.com or download it in super high quality at PrisonPlanet.tv. Welcome back to InfoWars Nightly News on this October 3rd, 2011, Tuesday edition. And we're going to close out this transmission with a closer look at the unfolding global financial meltdown. Bernanke saying we're on the verge of a new downturn. We never left the recession. We've been in a depression, according to the dozens of respected economists and financial experts that I've interviewed over the years. And Naomi Prinz, of course, was the managing director at Goldman Sachs. She also worked with other big companies in large global strategic outlooks. So she was able to boil down the wide global image. And she's been talking about on our show for the last few years, but a lot longer before that in her best-selling nonfiction books about these robber barons and this system they've set up. So I wanted to get her on to talk about the deepening crisis in the world meltdown, and also wanted to get her view on Occupy Wall Street. Naomi Prinz, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Alex.
Well, where do you want to start? Because, I mean, here it is. It's only getting worse. Let's get into the global financial crisis and where you see it going, and then let's talk about the Occupy Wall Street and your new book.
Well, first of all, you know, as you just mentioned, and as we've talked about tons of times in the past on your show, and I have in other places, we're not going into a second dip. This is not an additional weakening. This is part of the same unfolding of the depression in which we find ourselves, and it is a second depression. It is, for many, many reasons, as bad as Great Depression 1. They're slightly altered, but they're very similar in that there was a group of bankers that emanated from Wall Street and diffused into the global economy that basically concocted a pyramid of risk, of speculation, of derivatives, of toxic assets, pick your poison, and proliferated the world with this risk. And when it became known and apparent that what was inside of these assets, these securities that were used also as chips on the betting table to purchase more and to inflate this whole toxic asset bubble globally more, everything fell apart, and it's still falling apart. And what the bankers, what Wall Street have not done and have not been forced to do in all of this, not forced by Congress on any party, not forced by the Fed, not forced by the Treasury Department, is to act actually show that hand, to say, you know, this is what we created, to be held accountable for the fraud and the criminality involved, for the larceny that it took from the rest of the world, and the fact that these problems still exist. These assets are still in the world. There are still borrowed money that these banks have used to bet on other things with these assets as chips. It continues to move on, and that's why we're in a second Great Depression. There's no real money left to be used productively to create jobs, to create an infrastructure on the bottom level of the economy that works for most of the population. So instead, we have all of these continued practices going unabated. We have the Federal Reserve, we have the central banks in Europe, the ECB, we have the IMF, everyone throwing money at these banks, at the investors that were involved in these securities and these assets and these derivatives and this leverage throughout the world, rather than trying to fix the problem, which is closing it down, figuring out where the risk was, getting rid of it, shutting down the institutions that need to be shut down, and not continuing to print money to continue to make this thing work further into the depression. And that just hasn't happened yet. And that's why we are not at a point where we're turning around. We haven't turned around. We're continuing to go into this economic rabbit hole, this dark hole, and it isn't changing yet.
Naomi, I'm seeing George Soros, I'm seeing Democratic Party operatives, MoveOn.org, admitting that they basically, from day one, have been trying to take over the Occupy Wall Street movement. But now the idea of Wall Street being corrupt and the trillions missing and not knowing where the bailout money went, that's caught fire across the country. And we've got reporters all over the U.S. We've sent reporters to New York and other areas. The demonstrators themselves are pretty savvy and awake, but the mainstream media is giving attention to mainly Democratic Party operatives, who, again, are just part of the same crew as the Republicans. And they're saying, what we want is higher taxes on the rich, and Warren Buffett's promoting that, but he's basically exempt from the taxes. What they want is more taxpayer money, VAT, sales tax, increased income tax, to pay that in austerity money to the banksters and for new bailouts, as we see happening in Europe. So I see that as the big danger here. And that's why I've called for nationwide demonstrations kicking off this Friday to occupy Federal Reserve locations, not just say capitalism, free market, Wall Street's evil. Michael Moore says communism's the way to go. Capitalism's bad. Roseanne Barr says cut people's heads off. Re-education camps. I mean, they're selling communism, another form of tyranny, as a solution for this crony capitalism or crony monopoly, this monopoly man type system. I mean, A, do you agree with what I've just said? And B, can you elaborate on it?
That's the thing. The issue with all of these isms, you know, whether they're coming from Republicans, whether they're coming from Democrats, you know, first of all, both of these parties and both of their leaders, you know, President Bush, President Obama, it doesn't matter. For one thing, they equally supported and appointed Ben Bernanke, who's the current Federal Reserve leader. So there's no...
They got rid of Glass-Steagall. They allowed the derivatives.
Exactly. And what they allowed, and all of that, and let's not forget, the Federal Reserve is supposed to be the regulatory body in this country that is supposed to monitor the banking system. And instead of monitoring the banking system when it was creating all this risk, when it was diffusing all of these derivatives throughout the country, throughout people's pensions here, the small towns in Iceland, in Greece, in Norway, basically wrecking the world, right? Instead of containing that, instead of breaking up the banks, instead of saying, you know what, this is bad for the overall economy, you are going to basically screw things up, and we will be taking the fallout for years and years and years to come. So I absolutely agree with you, Alex, that the Federal Reserve, the ECB in Europe, that basically they are a part of, they're a part of why Wall Street has been able to do what it did. They're the fuel on the fire. They're the feeding mechanism. Without the Fed printing money, subsidizing the risk, guaranteeing big banks to become bigger. For example, JP Morgan Chase, when it bought Bear Stearns in March of 2008, they didn't buy that. They basically had the government, us, back the risk. That risk of the defaults of the assets that it bought from Bear Stearns when it became a bigger bank by sucking it into its mechanism were backed by the Federal Reserve, therefore, you know, and the Treasury Department and us. That's not a healthy way to run an economy. They are tremendously at fault, and it is something that needs to be adopted into the message, because without the mechanism for printing money, for subsidizing risk that hurts the rest of the population, this mechanism wouldn't be able to have gotten as big as it got.
Sure.
And it wouldn't be maintaining itself right now under the premise, under the illusion that somehow there's, for example, in the United States, the banks are somehow healthier, which they are not. They are insolvent. They are made to appear healthy by the fact that they're not marking their books correctly, they don't have to, and they're being subsidized and funneled with cheap money and guarantees and loans and other kinds of subsidies from the Federal Reserve.
Well, Naomi, I want to go back to the question, though, because I totally agree with you. Federal Reserve, European Central Bank, all part of the same consortium of these big six mega banks who created the tens of trillions in derivatives. Now they infect everything and hold the whole financial system hostage, saying, give us more power or we'll destroy everything. Clearly, there's a method to the madness where they create Ponzi schemes so big that instead of going to jail like Ponzi or Bernie Madoff, they get the world. So clearly this is premeditated, and now they're announcing this Bank of the World and austerity. I was just getting you to speak to Obama being Wall Street finance, just like the Republican leadership, but having the gall, Republicans, you know, mainline, just say Wall Street can do no wrong, give them banker bailouts, that's conservative, but welfare moms are evil. They're hypocritical, it's obvious, it's silly. But with Democrats, they're coming out saying capitalism's the problem, when it has nothing to do with it, that government teamed up with mega banks and tied taxpayer money to it. I mean, that's nothing but an insider monopoly scam. I was wanting to get your take just on this spectacle of Michael Moore and all these people lecturing us, saying capitalism doesn't work, and then demonizing the entire private property system because a group of monopolists teamed up with government to screw us.
Well, I mean, that's saying that this isn't what, you know, classical capitalism was defined to be. This isn't everybody has an equal opportunity to get ahead and to create a business and to produce and to have a job and to create a job and all of that. That's not what happened here. Well, you're right. What happened here was a completely lopsided way of funneling money into the wrong risks that had the knock-on effect of creating a decimated global economy and a depressed economy. This isn't, you know, classical capitalism. So sort of moaning on just capitalism, and I think capitalism can work if it's a progressive kind of capitalism where there actually is a fairness to this, you know, where banks that have to fail, where people can get the right amount of money for jobs that actually exist in order to feed their families.
Yeah, you don't give $16 trillion in bailout money to banks and then they hoard it and use it to not loan and shut down their whole service sector. I mean, it's incredible. We need to get back to free credit, basically, government issued. That's the American system, pre-1913 Federal Reserve. And then if people want to loan their private money, that's another issue. But to watch tens of trillions of dollars just given to these people and then they hoard it is incredible. Now, going back 7-8 years ago, you're a big managing director, you're moving up the ladder to, you know, the top of Goldman Sachs, and you quit, you leave, you start writing best-selling books like It Takes a Pillage, Other People's Money, Jacked, and other books. You started writing for The Nation, for Alternet, for Fortune, Mother Jones, you know, BBC, CNBC, MSNBC, CNN, PBS. You start coming out against them. And I remember seeing videos of you 5-6 years ago when the financial crisis hadn't happened yet. This wasn't on the radar. You were warning. So I want to go back to square one before we bring it to the future and where you see the world going. What did you see inside Goldman Sachs and inside, you know, the highest levels of the global financial ruling class? What did you see that made you get out of there?
Well, I saw, and I left right after Enron and WorldCom and the last spate of frauds that we all remember. And what I saw was, you know, a tremendous amount of manipulation and lying. I had a boss who is now one of the senior, well, boss's boss, who basically ran the credit division at the time, which was, you know, where credit derivatives were kind of spawned and born. And that business obviously grew out of control over the many years since, who would basically boast about his trips to Washington. You know, we can't have this meeting because I'm going to be in Washington. And why they were in Washington.